Hello, everybody. My family and I would like to thank you all for coming. We appreciate your thoughtfulness. And I also would like to thank my family because they've been the pillar of my strength. When my dear Gary was well and full of life, we talked about what he wanted, what he would like at this time. And he said, oh, I want a big celebration of life with all my family, my friends, and my colleagues. So we thank you all from the bottom of our hearts for making Gary's wishes come true. Thank you.
Thank you, Mom, and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Brian Heppel, along with my sisters, Leanne and Gail. We would like to welcome you and thank you for coming. Today, we are here to celebrate the life of Gary Heppel, who will be forever missed as a husband, a father, a grandfather, and a great-grandfather. Gary is survived by, of course, his wife, Maxine, three children, six grandchildren, five great-grandchildren, and oh, yes, more on the way. We have two more grandchildren that would be born in the next couple of weeks in beautiful downtown Edmonton. So we're Skyping in the mums-to-be, Kelsey and Stephanie, to the celebration of life. They would have been loved to be here, but certainly they're on the no-fly list with the airlines right now. And Kelsey and Stephanie also reminded everyone that Grandpa wouldn't want us to have the babies on the Coca-Cola. So hi, ladies. Hope you're doing well. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Our dad was an upbeat guy, and as such, he wanted his celebration of life to be as positive as can be and was always a proponent of the show must go on. Born August 17, 1936, to Eva and David Leslie Heppel, he grew up in Cloverdale, B.C., with siblings Clarence Heppel, Sharon Collins, and Kay Heppel. And along with them, many Heppel cousins, as my grandfather Heppel and his twin brother had the adjoining farms on Halls Prairie Road, which is better known now as 184th Street in Cloverdale. What a wonderful place to grow up, and what a wonderful place for so many family memories. We look forward to holidays on the farm in White Rock Beach, and let me tell you, when you've lived part of your life in northern communities and the winter is finally over, you definitely look forward to holidays at Grandpa and Grandma's house. I know Mom and Dad did too, because I think we would make the trip virtually nonstop from Fort St. John, and Dad would be bragging about the record time that he had made the trip, and you could hear him saying, if it wasn't for the gas and had to feed the kids, we would have been there even quicker. Our dad was a storyteller. The Heppel family is storytellers. And the real cool thing is some of the stories are even true. Our dad built a culture at work, and he built a culture at home by telling stories that brought people together in a comfortable, non-intimidating fashion, whether it was delivering key messages, giving advice, or even giving in the odd kick in the pants to get you going. Dad had a gift, whereas people wanted to talk to him no matter what the situation. He had a way of making people feel at ease, and they trusted him. He talked of Overweighty with a passion as our company. He talked of Overweighty team members as family members, and he knew more than their work lives. He knew their extended family lives. He was happy for them in the good times, and he felt for them when times were tough. I remember this great example of someone wanting to talk to Dad. We were on the golf course in Arizona, and this guy yells over, "Hey, Gary!" They chatted for a while, and when I asked him who that was, he said, "Oh, it was a guy in Quesnel that I hired in 1970. And get this, and then I had to let go in 1980. And I said, "You gotta be kidding me. Like, this guy still wanted to talk to you? Why would he want to talk to you?" He said, "When dealing with situations, you have to do your homework. and get the facts right. And even in the toughest conversations, don't attack them personally, and always, always leave them with their dignity. He must have done that a lot, because you could be in the Australian outback and somebody would yell out, "Hey, Gary!" And I remember my sisters and I thinking, here's an hour we're never going to get back. But certainly, just all in a day's work for our dad. I would like to recognize my mom and dad, but specifically the huge role that my mom plays in the family and in our lives. Although my dad was this gregarious personality at work, my mom was actually the president of family and corporate household affairs. And she was really good at it. In our house, when Maxie spoke, everybody listened, including my dad. The truth be known, Dad couldn't even boil water. And much less, he didn't know how to match a tie with a shirt and a pair of pants. When my dad would go on business trips, my mom would do the packing and, get this, put notes on all the outfits so that they were perfectly coordinated. My mom was an individual that is about detail, and I remember this one particular occasion when mom saw a picture of my dad and he was wearing the wrong tie and the wrong shirt. Oh man. You should have been at the Sunday morning board meeting my mom called to go over how easy it is to execute a step-by-step coordination wardrobe. Once the speech was over, my dad said, "Not doing that mistake again." Might even stay clear of my picture being taken. For 59 years, my mom and dad did everything together, especially through the retirement years. You rarely saw one without the other. Through the last few days in the hospital, my mom bedside day and home. The one cool memory for all of us was when mom gave dad a kiss and said, "Gary, aren't you going to give me a kiss back?" And even though he'd been silent for several days, we all saw him move his lips. We knew and we sensed us all there and that we were with him.
When your legs don't work like they used to before, and I can't sweep you off of your feet, will your mouth still remember the taste of my love? Will your eyes still smile from your cheeks? Darling, I will be loving you till we're 70. And baby, my heart could still fall as hard at 23. And I'm thinking about me, I fall in love with you every single day, and I just wanna tell you I am. So honey, now take me into your loving arms, kiss me under the light of a thousand stars, place your head. Thinking out loud, maybe we found love right where we are. When my hair's all but gone and my memory fades, and the crowds don't remember my name, when my hands don't play the strings the same way, I know you will still love me the same. 'Cause honey, your soul could never grow old, it's evergreen. Baby, your smile's forever in my mind and memory. And maybe it's all part of a plan. Well, I'll just keep on making the same mistakes, hoping that you'll understand. The baby now, take me into your loving arms, kiss me.
I'd like to invite long-term friend and overweight alumni Jerry Durkatz to say a few words. Jerry and Dad go way back, and certainly they were a big part of the team that built the early foundation of the Overdie Food Group. Jerry Durkatz.
Thanks, Brian. I met Gary in Cranbrook for the first time over 50 years ago. He was being transferred to another store that I was going to be next assistant manager for, store manager Archie Bryden. Gary wished me well and told me that Archie was a wonderful manager and that I would enjoy Cranbrook. Gary talked highly of his family. He loved his three children, Leanne, Gail, and Brian, his wonderful wife, Maxine, and all their grandchildren and great-grandchildren. He took his responsibilities seriously and showed a passion for understanding people. At work, whenever someone came to him for advice, he'd put his arm around them and say, "Don't worry, it'll work out." He was fair, but firm. And I'm sure many of our friends here today would concur. Gary loved being with people, enjoyed parties, storytelling, and known to be one to go to bed last. Gary was proud, a passionate, overweighty supporter, inside and outside. He had the greatest respect for the company that he loved and worked for. At a store manager's convention, after dinner, the store managers would meet in Gary's hotel room to bring points forward they would like to see. And Gary would listen, and then he would say, "Guys, I've got 10 votes and you have one." I remember a fishing trip that we took to Sonora one year, and we left on the Friday afternoon. We had to work Friday mornings. Clarence and Doug insisted that we had to put in a half a day. So we fly out to Sonora that Friday afternoon, and we fished on Saturday and Sunday morning. So on Saturday morning, we had our boat put out with a guide, and I was Gary's partner in the boat. So we got out that Saturday morning at 7 o'clock. We fished till noon, never got a bite. So then we went back to the lodge for lunch, and at 2 o'clock we went out again to try to catch this doggone salmon. So we're sitting there, and Gary says to the guide, "Where are the fish?" And the guide said, "Oh, you should have been here last week. They were just killing them." So as time went on, a couple of hours later, all of a sudden, Gary's line just goes zzz, and I thought, oh, here, we've got a fish. So he stands up, and the guide's saying, "Keep your hook up, or keep your line up," and then for the fish would go out again, and Gary is out there holding on, and then he's holding on this way, and I'm standing there watching this, and I said to Gary, is it a slab? And Gary says, "Oh, Jerry, it's big. It's really big." So finally, at approximately 15 minutes, he brought the fish in. And here was a 12-pound salmon, a very nice salmon. So I looked at Gary, and you should have seen he had the biggest smile going, and you thought he had won the lottery. Over the years, while Gary was having his health problems, I gave Gary many calls, and we had a lot of good laughs, and he was in good spirits at that time. And he always mentioned to me at times, he said to me, "Jerry," he said, "you know, I'm going to beat this damn cancer." So here a few weeks before our reunion in Penticton this year, I gave him a call, and I said, "Gary, this is the first reunion you and Maxie are going to be missing, and we're really going to miss you, and we're really going to, our thoughts are going to be at Penticton for you." And there was a pause, and Gary said to me, "Jerry, thank you for everything that you have done." But he said, "You know, I'm really sick and very tired." And I said to Gary, "I understand." And I said, "I wish you well, and we'll be thinking of you." And then I kind of sat down, or I hung up the phone and sat down and thought, and I broke out in tears. And then I said to myself, what a great friend. Will be missed, but not forgotten. Thank you.
Might not want to lose these, eh? Yeah, there you go. Okay, thank you very much, Jerry. Now I'd like to invite up Overworthy colleague and friend Brent Louth to say a few words. Brent and Dad have known each other for years, as Brent predominantly was working on the merchandising side of the business, and my dad spent his career on the operations side of the business. Both very important roles, considering ultimately their work translated into what our customers ultimately experience in our stores. So, Mr. Brent Louth.
Thank you. Thank you, Brian. Good afternoon, everyone. What a gathering. My name is Brent Louth, and I worked with Gary for a good many years. And I could stand up here for the next hour and only scratch the surface, telling you what a great mentor Gary was to me. How much heart he put into his job, and how great his contribution to the company and my career were. But I'm sure you'll hear plenty today about Gary, the overweighty executive, and his 40-plus year career. Instead, I'd like to spend a couple of minutes talking about his friendship to me and what he did to keep the overweighty spirit alive through the overweighty alumni group. As most of you know, the Alumni Organization Committee hosts a fairly major event every couple of years, plus five or so luncheons per year. Now, remember the people on this committee are all retired members of the overweighty team. I think it's fair to say that every one of us are driven achievers and passionate about the company, and maybe just a bit domineering and impatient. Well, whether we were retired 5 years ago, 15 years ago, or even 25 years ago, not a lot has changed in that regard. Often reaching a consensus on event details was no small challenge. But that's where Gary came in. When we worked with him, we all had tremendous respect for his leadership as our executive vice president, and yet, even though not officially our leader over the past 20 years, it really didn't matter. He still was. He didn't dominate every discussion or push his own agenda, but he certainly did lead us. He would sit back and listen to everyone as they debated the issues. Then he would ask simple, quiet questions designed to calm everyone down and show each person respect. His big heart and positive attitude were always in the forefront. Not only did he make us feel important, but also cherished. His unique style brought out the best in people. Gary loved people, and he truly came alive when others succeeded. If only everyone cared that much about others having their time to shine, our world would be a better place. Over the course of Gary's career, there were times when I saw he had to make decisions on behalf of the company that would be difficult for some people to accept. It was at these times that he showed the most heart and truly stood above the rest. He would always treat the people involved with the utmost respect and dignity, never walking away until he was satisfied that they were going to be okay and still feel part of or friends of the overweighty family. To me, his deep caring and empathy are his legacy, whether as an executive, husband, father, grandfather, or as a personal friend. Gary loved his family. He was proud of each and every one of them. He was the first to admit that without Maxine's strength and support, he could never have enjoyed the successful career he had. But more importantly, he counted on her to keep the three children safe, happy, and together, and together they raised a beautiful and loving family. But if I were honest, we each have only a very few true friends. And I'm willing to bet that many, many people in this room counted Gary as one of theirs. I certainly know I did. He always had time for me to celebrate with me during my high points in my life and to pick me up and brush me off during the lows. Life can get very busy, and despite good intentions, friends can't always show up when you need them, except for Gary. He never hesitated for a moment. Or if you reached out to him, he always made sure you didn't feel like you were intruding. Plain and simple, being around Gary was fun. You could not help but enjoy yourself in the presence of someone so full of life and laughter. Having a good time came natural to Gary, and he never took himself too seriously, even after he got sick. While most of us would have curled up in a ball and felt sorry for ourselves, he stood tall and continued to deflect attention away from himself. I would call and tell him that I was thinking about him, and he would quickly move the conversation to what Karen and I were up to. We have many, many great memories of spending time with Gary and Maxine, both in a group and one-on-one, and always look forward to the opportunity of doing it again. We had amazing times over the years. We were in China when we heard that Gary had left us. And even knowing how ill he had been, the news still brought me to my knees, knowing that I won't have the chance to simply sit and talk with him again has left an empty place in my heart. I know I'm a better person for having known him. Maxine, Brian, Gail, Leanne, and families, we all share your loss. And thank you for letting the overweighty family and all of us here to share the joy of Gary. As time moves on, I will always see my friend with his head back and laughing, just like that picture. So, thanks, Gary.
Thank you very much, Brent, for those kind words. Over the years, Julie Dixon Olmsted has been a friend of Mom and Dad's for 25 years plus. And it wasn't uncommon to hear that Julie had stopped over for a visit. And if it wasn't for just a visit, Julie was probably coordinating a speech or a function that my dad had to attend. Julie is now Director of Public Affairs and Corporate Services for the Overwoody Food Group. Julie, come on up.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you to Brian and to your family and Maxine for inviting me to speak today. I really appreciate it. 20 years ago, almost to the day, I had the honor and the privilege of standing up in front of a microphone like this one to give my thanks to a man who had given me so much. It was Gary Heppel's retirement celebration. He was my boss, my mentor, and a true leader. His gifts to me were sage advice, lessons about life and business, the occasional stern talking to, and he provided me with opportunity, education, friendship, and to be quite honest, a bit of a safety net. The result, confidence, maybe even a little bit of fearlessness, and with his support, I was pretty sure that there wasn't anything I couldn't figure out how to do if somebody asked me, but I wasn't sure what I was gonna do without him. I was 26, 8 years of service with the company, and to be quite honest, more than a little bit shocked that I had somehow managed to trick some very important people into thinking I earned a place on that stage. I remember way back then giving myself a little pep talk, kind of like this morning, holy crap, okay, you can do this. If you think you can, you can. I will not cry. I will make him proud. I have no idea how that speech actually went. But I do know this, I thought I could pull it off because in the years leading up to that moment, Gary Heppel had made me somehow believe that I could do anything. In the 20 years or so after that last speech, I came to realize that I really had nothing to worry about that day because though Gary had retired, he'd never really left us at all. In real life, he was still my friend, someone I could call up and ask for advice or help with a project or just get a laugh. He was always happy to help, and just to keep me on my toes, asked me to work on the occasional speech with him too. It was always so much fun. And at work, he was kind of always with me. The lessons were solid, the values well ingrained, and his principles well taught. Never forget where you came from. Pay attention to details. So he must have been listening to you, Maxine. Little things are not little things. Never ever answer a question you don't know the answer to. Look after people and they will look after the rest. If it isn't fun, you shouldn't be doing it. And every day is a good day. He was one of those people that I would just simply never let down, and still wouldn't. Gary had such high standards and an amazing capacity to learn and remember details, and he just loved people. In all the years I've known Gary, some 28, I don't think I ever once heard him complain or say a bad word about anybody. Gary saw the good and the potential in everything and everybody, and he made us all feel special. Like we mattered, like we individually and more importantly, collectively could do anything, beat anyone, win, and have fun doing it. And I think it made all of us want to give just a little bit more because of it. It sure worked for me anyway. If I had to try and explain Gary to someone who didn't know him, I guess I would say this. Gary had a magic about him, a zest for life, infectious enthusiasm, endless energy, and above all else, he was just such a great teacher. And even though he's left this earth, I don't think he's really gone. I don't think it's possible. He's just simply left too much of himself behind. We are all blessed for having known him, and I, for one, am so grateful. So, I don't have a glass of wine, which is odd for me, but I'm gonna pretend. We can do it later. But here's one last toast to Gary, a little bit like the one I gave 20 years ago, which in the end was to say thanks rather than goodbye. So here's to Gary. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Julie. Very pleased now to have Brian Pewick say a few words today, as my dad and Brian go back a long ways. So far back that at one time, my dad was a store manager in Cranbrook, and this Cranbrook thing keeps coming up, and Brian was his assistant manager. As it turns out, years later, Brian became the president of the Overwoody Food Group, and my dad became Brian's right-hand man. They were together in the tough times, and they were together in the good times, and certainly were part of the huge growth and the evolution of the Overwoody Save-On Foods stores. Folks, Mr. Brian Pewick.
Thank you. Well, it's probably one of the most difficult times for me to ever speak. Gary was more than an employer, more than a boss, more than a mentor. He was such a deep friend of mine and, of course, a lot of people in this room. I started thinking when the last time I talked to him, and this is unfortunate, but like many in this room, I'd called Gary on occasion to see how he was doing, more towards as he was sick. But then there was a time when he said to me, "My family's here, Brian, and I want you to speak at my ceremony." And I said, "Well, I'm sorry to hear this is where it's at, Gary." He said, "Yeah, it is." He said, "So, well, good luck, and good luck to you." I never talked to him after that because I think that was what he wanted to say, is goodbye. It was tough. It was very emotional because what's a life without Gary Heppel? I mean, I've known him for so long. I'd like to talk a bit about his career because I know a little bit about Gary, the fun things too, as you well know, but as an operator. And to that, I'll tell you that once Jimmy, way back when, you probably don't remember this, but you said, I was talking to you about something, and I said, "You know that guy there, he's got an MBA, came from this university," and you turned to me and you said, "You know, Brian, you can get all kinds of MBAs, but to get a good operator, a guy that works hard, loves the company, and puts his heart out every single day, those people are hard to get." I don't know if you recall that. But certainly, that was Gary Heppel. He was Mr. Overweighty. He was Mr. Grocer. Now, as it turns out in my life, I ended up working in 2 provinces and 10 states. I have never met anybody as good at his job as Gary Heppel, a person that knew the business right down to his soul. He knew everything about it. He knew produce. He knew meats. He knew the people. He knew the importance of getting people motivated to deliver a profit. Now, Overweighty's often accused of being a very innovative, Daryl, business. Well, innovation is often very expensive, but if taking a good idea and making it into a great idea with enthusiasm and dedication and effort and energy, if that's innovation, Overweighty, there's nobody better. And that was Gary Heppel. So many ideas came up at Overweighty that were taken from the top and given to Gary, execute, and he did. And everybody said, if Gary said, let's do it, and let's get her done, because that's the kind of person he was. You know, we talk about people that are enthusiastic for the business. Is there anybody that anybody in this room knows that was more enthusiastic for Overweighty in the business than Gary Heppel? Nobody. Nobody. The culture of the company today is a direct result of the enthusiasm, the energy, the heart that Gary Heppel put into the company. The things that go on today are because of, in no small way, what everybody thought about the head office. He was, you know something? When we were district managers, every single person in the company wanted Gary Heppel's job. Every single, he made it look so easy, so relaxed. I want that job. So true. It wasn't easy. He did have to let people go. He had to hire people. He had to demote people. He had to promote people. That's not easy. But he had a way of doing it that everybody respected so much. I have a story that goes back to Cranbrook, Brian. It was when I was running the store because Archie Bryden, if anybody remembers Archie Bryden, I think you might, Daryl. Archie Bryden, maybe an understatement, Jerry, didn't work hard. In fact, he didn't do anything. The very first day that I came there, Archie took me around and introduced me to the staff. And then the next day, I kind of was looking for Archie, but he wasn't there. And I thought, well, he's probably got something going on. So the next day after that, I thought, well, maybe I should ask. Where's Archie? Well, he's gone hunting for 2 weeks. That was Archie. Well, roll ahead a couple of years from that, or a year and a half from that. Gary Heppel, my first time I met him, came to Cranbrook, and he was the manager. Now, understand that up until then, I was running the store. So who wants to go backwards, right? So Gary could have made a way to tell everybody that he was the boss. He didn't do that. He took me aside one day and said, you know what? You've been doing a really good job in this company, but now I'm here, and I'm the manager, and you're going to have to take the role of assistant manager, and this is how we're going to do it. Nobody else knew that this conversation happened, but with such dignity and respect, unbelievable. And that's what everybody that I think that knows your dad, Brian, that's what they remember about your dad. Now, we did have some good times. No, we had a number of good times, maybe more than a number. But I remember one, and it's funny, and I shouldn't tell this story. I really shouldn't, Maxine, but I'm going to anyway. It was when we first met. We were in Cranbrook, and we'd gone out for some occasion, which I can't remember. Not that there necessarily had to be an occasion, but we did go out. And we went, there was somebody that you knew at the fire hall. I think it was Betty's husband, if I'm not mistaken. And so we stopped there, and then they said, y'all better go home because, you know, you've had a few drinks. So I didn't live very far away, so I walked, and Gary got a ride. And the next day, I went and picked the car up. The car was parked in the middle of the road. And we just sat down with each other, and we said, that'll never, ever happen again. From now on, one of us gets out and finds the curb. No, we had a great time. And you know, the thing was that he could have a good time, but it was always about business. Whenever we sat down, and by the way, I don't have to tell this story either, but I've only been thrown out of a pub once. And it wasn't Gary and I. It was with Maxine and Bernice, and Leanne and Sue. And it wasn't our fault either, Sue and Leanne. No, but it was... He was that kind of person you just love to sit down and have a good time with. But even though you did that with him, you never lost sight of the fact that the business was the business. And we would sit many evenings, talk about our families. We talk about the business. We talk about Overweighty. We talk about all the people. And we used to have a great time. But always about the company, always about the great family at Overweighty Food Group. Maxine, Leanne, Sue, Brian, I'm so proud to have him as a friend. He really was. Thank you. Simply the best. Better than all the rest. Better than anyone. Now that we're the best in the West. We'll be right back.
working together, we're the best we can be. Hand in hand, you're the winning team. You know what we share, there's a feeling in the air. It's a right type of sharing our goals and our dreams. We're staying on top and we know what it means. Oh, there's so much in store. Together everyone's achieving more. You're simply the best. Better. Of tomorrow's in our hands today. We're looking into the future as we lead the way. Just as long as you're here on the team, we could be in no better place. You're simply the best.
Well, great pictures there, eh? Nobody does it like Overwood, eh? Fantastic.
Up next to say a few words is the president of the Overty Food Group, Mr. Daryl Jones. My dad loved this guy. From working with Daryl in his younger years and seeing Daryl say, man, with the company expanding into Winnipeg in the next month, my dad would get this little grin on his face and say, wow, our company is a true Western Canadian business, and think of all the new customers and think about all the new opportunities for team members. You guys must be having the time of your lives. Mr. Daryl Jones.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Maxine, for the honor to get a chance to talk about somebody who is extraordinarily special to all of us in this room, our good friend Gary Heppel. Be somebody that makes everybody feel like they're a somebody. Doesn't that describe our friend Gary Heppel? As soon as I saw that, we saw that really describes Gary. He is always able to make everybody feel like a somebody. That was who he was, right down to the roots of Gary. For many of us, Overwoody Foods and Gary, he was like an institution with our company in the best of ways. Gary was the quintessential people guy in the Overwoody Food Group. Everywhere he went, it seemed like he knew the impossible. He knew who everybody was, remembered their families, he asked about their hobbies, how they were doing back home. He seemed to know where everybody come from. Ian and White came from Cranbrook because he spent time with Cranbrook, and Brian was in Cranbrook. Cranbrook had a lot of things happening when Gary and Brian were there, as you heard. He came to every person that he met and made them feel better than they did before they'd met him. He moved us, he mentored us, he coached us, and sometimes, yeah, he even remediated us. But through it all, he made every single one of us feel respected, motivated, and special. Gary made all of us believe, a person at a time, that together we could accomplish just about anything. And I can tell you that on a personal level, Gary always was the one person that truly inspired me with his ability to know the people and connect with the people. Gary truly was a very special Woody guy. And I don't just mean the management folks. He was able to connect with everybody, right down to the person who started the day before, the next day. Gary truly believed that if you understand and cared about people, they would care about you. Work hard, be happy to do more, have fun while you're doing it, always 100%. That was Gary's motto. He loved his job, he loved our company, and he came to work every day excited to be there. He truly was, Brian, you said he was Mr. Overweighty. Through and through, Gary was Mr. Overweighty. Gary worked for the company for 42 years, but you know what? He was part of Overweighty for over 60 years. I would see Gary every time I seen him. He always was so encouraging to me and so encouraging to where the company was going. And it's nice to hear those words from you, Brian, that where the company's going, but that's what Gary was. Every day that I ever saw him, he was always so encouraging to us and to our company. He, like most of us, got his start as a very young man, as a clerk in the local store, took his family on many sightseeing adventures as he moved from town to town to build his career. Throughout the span of this incredible career, he reached the pinnacle as executive vice president. Gary truly became known, as I said a moment ago, as a man of the people. He was arguably one of the most influential forces in the entire company. And he will be missed so dearly. I personally got to know Gary much better after he retired. He was never very far away and always somebody we could count on. As Brent said at the alumni events, scholarship award presentation, our 100th birthday celebration, and just about anything that we ever asked Gary to do associated with Overwoody, with a huge smile on his face, he came and helped and did whatever he could to support the company. Gary taught us that if you look at life the right way, you could have it all. Friends, family, success, fun, and that, folks, is the very definition of a long and successful life. He was responsible for making many generations of young people believe in themselves and that they could accomplish what we could accomplish together was anything. He played a huge role in creating the culture that propelled us forward today. Brian said it. Brian, you're absolutely right. Overweighty's culture is the way that it is today, to a large degree, because of the incredible personnel, the incredible effort that Gary put into the company. He played a huge role that we can never forget. And because of that, his mark and his memory will live on in this company for generations to come. I guarantee it. Personally guarantee it. Gary's life ended much too soon. We'll all miss him dearly, but we're also lucky and grateful for having him in our company, giving us his strength that he gave us each and every day. So I'd like to conclude my remarks by saying thanks to Gary for all he's done for us with such passion and such commitment, and to thank you and Maxine and your family for sharing with us this very, very special man for all those years. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Daryl. Thanks very much for those kind words. Very, very honored today to be able to introduce Jimmy Patterson as our next speaker. My dad worked for the company for 42 years, and the respect and the admiration he had for Jimmy as a person and as a businessman goes without saying. The Heppel clan has been a big part of the Overwoody Food Group for four decades, and my dad and my uncle Clarence used to say, we have been so, so fortunate that Jimmy trusted in us, invested into the Overwoody Food Group so that we could build the company, build our careers, and ultimately build our families. Folks, Mr. Jimmy Patterson.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for including me in your program today. I really much appreciate that. This is a very special occasion, and I just wanted to say that Gary Heppel is one of the finest people I've ever met. When I first got involved with Overweighty, which is 48 years ago, after that period, I had met Gary in the subsequent years, and from time to time, I would see him, and at some company events and things, but really, I didn't know him very well. Then one day when I was visiting some Overweighty stores along Highway 16, which was like Fort St. James and Burns Lake and Terrace and Kitimat, Prince Rupert. I think a lot of the folks know that route. And I was driving along through there calling on the stores, and I accidentally bumped into Gary. He was on some project up in the north there, and I unexpectedly ran into him, and so we spent some time together for a couple of days, and then I flew him back on our plane out of Terrace, and at the end of that trip, I realized that Gary Heppel was a very special person. And that's when I really got to have an inside look at what this man was all about. In building a company like Overweighty, which I have now been with for 48 years, And it always takes a team. You can never do anything on your own. If you're going to accomplish something, it always takes a team to do it. And Gary totally supported his brother Clarence when he became the president. And Gary, became very much involved and was very important at the time when we started. In those days, our market share in Overweighty was 2% of the province of British Columbia. As our company, Overweighty, we would not be here today if it had not been for Gary Heppel and the team that his brother Clarence put together, and the successor presidents that some are here today, and their management teams, many whom are in this room today, and with the unique, one-of-a-kind culture that is the bedrock of this successful company. Over the years, I can never remember hearing Gary say a mean-spirited word about anybody. Gary was always up. He was an enthusiastic family guy, company like we've seen Overweighty. It always takes a team, and Gary was the ultimate team player. Gary totally supported his brother Clarence and became a key part of the growth and success of Overweighty as it has continued to expand into Alberta, Saskatchewan, and shortly to be in Manitoba. As for our company Overweighty, we would not be here today if it had not been for Gary Heppel and the team that with his brother Clarence put together, as I said, with the successful presidents and the management teams that they had that followed them. And today, the unique, what I think it makes this company different is the unique, one-of-a-kind culture that is the bedrock of this successful company. And I think Brian talked about it, I think Daryl mentioned it a couple times, but this company, Overweighty, has a culture in it of which I have never seen in anything or any company I've been involved with. And that attitude and that commitment, it, in my opinion, started early in the days, certainly before I got involved, but it was the Heppel boys and the management that they came up with over the time and the successors that really put this company on the map. And today we have a very different company on our hands. Woodward's is gone. Safeway sold out. These are our big competitors. We are now competing with the largest company in the world, Walmart. Amazon's coming. But the Overweighty culture, with our strong management teams and employees, will do just fine. That's one thing I'm not worried about. With the attitude that's in this company, Overweighty, which has been there for years, is what really makes a difference. In conclusion, let me say that they don't make them better than Gary Heppel. Gary may have been one of the big bosses at work, but when he went home, the chairman lived there. Maxine, I want to thank you for the enormous support that you have given Gary and all of the Overweighty people over many, many years. You have been an important part of the success of the Overweighty group and the family. And I can thank you from the bottom of my heart because your contribution and the caring that you've put in to this company and the people has been a huge contributor. And I thank the family, the girls, and Gary, now with the time going forward, you're going to have to step up to the plate here now and compete with Walmart and Amazon and put all your talents with the rest of the boys together here and ladies to keep this company in good shape. And so thank everybody for your, while we have this opportunity, I want to thank everybody here for your help, commitment, and your support to the company. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jimmy. Very kind words, very much appreciated. Okay, up next, we're gonna hear from the grandchildren. And like I said earlier, we have the grandchildren back in Edmonton. Hope the popcorn's good, folks. I know you're relaxed there with the popcorn and whatever else. But first up, we're gonna have Brooklyn Heppel and Kristen Heppel. Whoops, Kristen McEwen. I don't know, they get married or something, they change their names. I don't know how that works. Sorry, Dustin, I guess she's, I still think she's mine, but she's actually yours, I guess. You can pay for her. All that teaching stuff she does. Okay, Brooklyn, come on up. Right here, sweetie.
Thanks, Dad.
Okay, there you go, sweetie.
Thanks, Dad. Hello, my name is Brooklyn Heppel, and I'm the youngest grandchild. I'm honored to be here. I'm gonna share some memories of time I spent with Grandpa. Grandpa, in my eyes, was my best friend. I've always thought that as a little girl. He was always there for me, picking me up from school, and sometimes going to Wendy's for lunch. I would always love to play dress-up with Grandpa, from tiaras, to capes, to necklaces, to tutus, and the good old clip-on earrings. And for his hair, sparkles, AKA pieces of cut up paper. Grandpa was always a good sport. Thank you for letting me share these great memories. And now I'm gonna pass the microphone to my sister, Kristen.
All right, I'm here to speak on behalf of the grandchildren, my sisters, Kelsey and Brooklyn, my brother, Curtis, and my cousins, Brittany and Blake, and of course our significant others. I'm not really sure how we are supposed to stand up here and give a speech about a man who is known for giving the most meaningful, heartfelt, and motivating speeches throughout his life. Let's just say it's intimidating to say the least. But here it goes. Grandpa, we will do our best. Our grandpa brought so many unforgettable memories and impactful lessons to our lives. We would like to share a small sampling of these with you all today. Our grandpa was a master storyteller, which has come up a couple times, so it's obviously a true trait. Whether he was talking to a small group of people or at a party or a whole auditorium, he was able to captivate every person in the room. As his grandchildren, we experienced this storyteller in a different way. Although it was very common for Grandpa to give a traditional speech at a big family dinner, we fondly remember the detailed stories that he shared with just us. We are still unsure how many of these stories or details, or the details in them, were actually fictional and how many were true, but nevertheless, we were captivated every time. On one of our many family houseboating trips, we remember one story in particular about a man who single-handedly sunk his own houseboat. There's a little bit of a private joke. Our grandpa's version of the story had many interesting details and became the main topic of conversation for the rest of the holiday. Although, I'm not sure about the timing of him telling us the story, as we were on a houseboat and some of us were not all that keen on the water. Well, Grandpa, you must have passed on some of that storytelling ability, because if any of you have ever been in the room at one of our family dinners, the noise level alone is an indication that we all have a story to tell. Our grandpa always encouraged us to strive to be our best, to reach our greatest potential. On one particular family holiday to Disneyland, Curtis and Blake took an interest in the job of the bellboy at our hotel. They were about 6 and 8, respectively, and the bellboy had a very sleek uniform with many shiny buttons that caught their eye. As you can see by Blake and Curtis's coordinated outfits today, fashion is still of the utmost importance to them. After several days of this bellboy helping us up and down the elevator, they said, "Grandpa, when I grow up, I want to press the buttons on the elevator and help people get to their hotel rooms." Now, keeping in mind that our grandpa was always supportive of our dreams, he encouraged us to dream big. So without batting an eye, Grandpa replied, "When you grow up, you are going to own the hotel." "And if you want to spend your days operating the elevator and helping people, well, then you can do that." Lesson learned, Grandpa. Thank you for always believing in us and helping us to push ourselves to be the best that we can be. We will continue to do this throughout our lives and pass this on to the generations coming up. Grandpa also taught us to be devoted in many ways and to many things, to our partners, our family, our friends, and our work. This was a lesson that our grandpa demonstrated to us through his own actions. Grandpa was devoted to his wife. Our grandma. Sorry. Through our eyes, we saw a couple that supported each other, enjoyed spending time together, and even after all those years, would still even flirt together. Watching our grandparents' relationship gave us an example of how to be truly devoted. Grandma, Grandpa loved you so much. Even when you wouldn't let him have that second or third chocolate treat after dinner. On the note of trying to sneak an extra treat or two, Grandma, you may or may not already know this, but one of Grandpa's favorite things was when Blake would arrive at a family dinner with a Bubba keg. They had an unspoken agreement that this would be the most discreet way for Grandpa to sneak an extra beer at dinner without you knowing. It was sort of their not-so-secret little secret. Back to being devoted. Grandpa was also devoted to his family. It didn't matter the distance, near or far. Grandma and Grandpa would travel to be with everyone for all family events, special birthdays, every sporting event, and even great-grandchildren being born. They also went above and beyond to ensure that we all could enjoy special holidays and memories together. It is rare to have the whole extended family able to spend so much time together, but this was important to them, so it became important to us. Because of their devotion, our grandma and grandpa have given us a gift, a family that is so close, so supportive, and so amazing. Aside from all the unforgettable memories and the impactful lessons, probably the most amazing thing about our grandpa is something that is difficult to describe in words. He had this uncanny ability to make you feel like the most important person in the world. Whenever you entered into a room, whether it had been a very long time since you had visited or you had just stepped out for a moment and then returned, just the way he would say our name or call us over warmed our hearts. This is what we will miss the most about our grandpa, just hearing him call our name. We would like to end with a quote by an unknown author. "Those we love don't go away. They walk beside us every day, unseen, unheard, but always near, still loved, still missed, and very dear. As we continue through this difficult time, we find peace in knowing that Grandpa will forever live in our hearts and continue to guide us throughout our lives. We love you, Grandpa."
Sometimes it feels like world's gone crazy. Grandpa, take me back to yesterday, when the line between right and wrong didn't seem so hazy. Did lovers really fall in love to stay? Stand beside each other, come what may. Promise really something people kept, not just something they would say. Families really bow their heads to pray. Daddies really never go away. Oh, oh, Grandpa, tell me about the good old
Well, some good shots there. Nice glasses, Gail. You see that? So up next, we're going to reflect a little bit, myself and my sisters, Gail and Leanne. So come on up. Do you want me to go first? I'm here anyway, so.
Always go.
I used to take quite a beating at home from these two, so.
Be careful.
All of a sudden, I had to start ironing my shirts when I was 15. Oh, man, so many memories, so many stories. But that's the positive that we take out of all of this. I started working for the Overwoody Food Group in 1974, and the plan was to graduate, go to university, but this food business thing had been part of my life for so many years, it kind of gets in your blood. Living at home to see our first jobs when we got up in the morning for school was to face the cupboards and rotate the refrigerator, kind of set the tone
for our love of the grocery business and the Overty Food Group. Because Dad and I work for the company, I think we had this unwritten understanding of each other because of the passion we have for the Overty Food Group, for the people, the products, and at the end of the day, the profit that comes from hard work and dedication. Dad led the way for all of us, and with the 1-2 leadership of Mom and Dad, we are, and our families, are doing great because of that mentorship. Now, it wasn't all puppy dogs and sunshine, as the saying goes. We've all had a few lessons along the way, and I definitely have had my fair share. I remember when Dad was a district manager on the road and would be gone Monday to Friday, and at times for weeks when they were opening a new store. I was a young guy, and I had an appetite for having fun. And sometimes my mom didn't have the same appreciation as I had for fun. I remember Dad coming home and saying, "Brian, I'm counting on you to help your mom out while I'm gone. You have to learn to be communicative, you have to learn to be collaborative, and you have to learn to get along with people if you ever want to be successful in this world. So please help your mom out while I'm away, because I don't care how right you think you are. I will side with your mom. And you will never, ever leave the house again. Look up the word house arrest, and you will see where you're headed, Brian. The choices are up to you." Thank you, Dad. Point taken, lesson learned. That was Dad, relatively quiet at home, not a big discipliner, but discussions with choices, unless you were driving off a cliff, would let you learn it the good old-fashioned way. Experience it. But always take responsibility and always be accountable for your actions. Played a lot of hockey when I was younger. Do you want to read it? Just give me a moment. And although my dad never played the game, he was an avid fan and he knew the game inside out. Driving the car to the hockey game, he was always so pumped, just pumped, and talking about what the best approach would be for me to take should I have a chance to play the game. And this one particular game, we were playing this team that at 14 years old had a 6-foot giant playing on the other team. And he was always on me, and he was always wanting to fight, sometimes even before the game even started. My dad said, we're driving in the car, and my dad said, "You know, Brian, the giant is trying to intimidate you. Starts punching me and starts becoming really aggressive. Now, I think I to say, Brian, I will always remember our conversations, the stories, the experiences, and all the things we did as a family. Dad was a proponent, you grow, you learn, you keep the family connected, and the next generation will lead. I don't know where I am. That is what he wanted, and that is exactly what we are going to do. Over to my sister Gail.
We shared our dad with Overweighty. Overweighty was his second family and his driving force. He was passionate and committed to his work and to the people he worked with. He had a special way of spreading his energized enthusiasm to the people who surrounded him and had an approachable management style that made people believe in themselves, as was his style at home. In Dad's career with Overweighty, we lived in Cranbrook, Ladysmith, Trail, Fort St. John, Mission, Cranbrook once more, and back to Mission. I remember my dad sitting us down for a family meeting when we were in our early teens, giving us the sales pitch. By this time, we clearly understood what was coming. Your mom and I have some really exciting news. We're moving to Cranbrook. Cranbrook has the most spectacular winters, and we will get snowmobiles and enjoy the winters together as a family. Well, we were only in Cranbrook for just over a year, and we never did see the snowmobiles. My dad was promoted to head office. He must have known. Dad and Mom unselfishly moved us back to Mission so we could reconnect with our friends. And Dad had to commute to Lake City for several years. These moves made our family only stronger, and Dad would say, only in his positive way, this will help build character, self-confidence, and diversity that will help you later in life. And just how lucky you guys are to be able to live and explore different communities in BC in your lifetime. And Dad was right. It made us who we are. We were only too happy when he got promoted into the office, because I remember my sister Leanne saying, thank God we don't have to stand up in front of a class and announce who we were and where we came from. With each move, Dad showed a sense of respect and involvement in the different communities that we lived in by being a volunteer fireman, joined local sport teams, and along with Mom, also joined local fundraising groups to meet new people and to introduce themselves as the new couple of the Overweighty store. Our dad certainly treated his colleagues at work like family, as you all know and loved. This was also evident, as it was not uncommon for Dad to get personal calls at home from colleagues who were sharing good news of marriages and births, as well as bad news of personal problems. My dad was always there for them at work, as well as away from work. And maybe that's just one of the examples of why he got his name, Mr. Overweighty. Dad devoted a lot of his time to Overweighty and its people, but he never forgot his biggest supporters, our mom and his family. Dad and Mom together always made time for us kids while we were growing up, supporting us in our personal growth, attending our sporting activities, and they continue to do so with their grandchildren right down to their great-grandchildren. We were so fortunate to go on many family holidays together, including Hawaii several times as kids, as well as with the grandkids, Disneyland, Arizona, Seychelles, and let's not forget what Kristen mentioned, the Shuswap houseboat trips. There's a couple of stories I'd like to share about my dad. We were all in Seychelles one Easter, and Dad had limbed some trees and had made a bonfire. He thought he would impress the grandkids, and he quietly put an aerosol can under the brush before setting it on fire. Shortly after, the fire had caught the aerosol can, blowing it hundreds of feet into the air. Well, it was all fun and games until a tree caught on fire. Needless to say, the grandkids were very impressed. Needless to say, the adults weren't impressed. And Dad was not allowed another match. Again, Dad was not a very domesticated kind of guy. When he said he made dinner, he really just set the table. When he said he made lunch, he really just opened a bag of popcorn. His attempts got out of hand when my mom had surgery, and Mom had asked Dad to bring her some dry toast. Dad proceeded to do so, but burnt the toast. This in turn set the smoke detector off, which alerted the security call center, which prompted a call to the house, asking my dad a couple of simple questions. What's your password? I'm not sure. What's your physical address? Let me run out and see. By this time, the fire and the police department were at the house over the burnt toast. After the fire and the police left, Dad promptly got the vacuum out. We're still shocked we didn't even know where he could find it, and vacuumed the toaster so he could remove all evidence that he burnt Mum's toast. And so when Maxie got home, she wouldn't find the burnt crumbs. Then he proceeded to jump into the car and go through the Dairy Queen drive-thru and got Mum a toasted bun and him a big banana split to distress himself. I won't go into another story where he'd put the metal pot in the microwave either, yet having another smoke alarm issue. That is only my dad. Clearly, the kitchen was not his forte, and maybe it was his way of being able to stay clear of the kitchen. When my dad got sick, and in his last year, we were so very fortunate to be able to return to Hawaii, Arizona, and Seychelles one more time with him. These are his favorite places, and these are memories with Mom and Dad, and along with our other family holidays that we will cherish for life. My dad said to me once, if people aren't talking about you, you haven't left your mark. Well, Dad, you have definitely left your mark. Look at how many people are here for you today. We love you, Dad, and we miss you already.
I always have to go last.
You're the youngest.
Our family will never be the same without Dad. We actually thought Dad would live forever. But I guess, as Abraham Lincoln once said, in the end, it's not the years in your life that count. It's the life in your years. Dad lived a wonderful and full 80 years of life. Many people are probably sitting there thinking, well, he was 80 when he died. How much longer do you expect? But for those that knew Dad prior to his devastating illness, most people thought Dad was in his 60s. He was young physically, and he was young in spirit. When I was going through the photo albums, I found a copy of Dad's speech he wrote for his retirement celebration. Mom kept everything from Dad's successful career of 42 years with the Overweighty Food Group and their 59 years of marriage. In his retirement speech, he started by acknowledging Mom and his family by saying, and I quote, "You've watched me grow from a carefree, fun-loving young man into a carefree, fun-loving older man with more good fortune than any single person could hope for in a lifetime." As you've heard, Dad committed his life to Overweighty. He said it was in his blood. And believe it or not, never finishing high school, I think he actually got kicked out for being a bit of a rascal, but he said it was to put food on the table. Anyways, regardless, he used to tell us that he graduated from the University of Overweighty. Dad also liked to say he had street smarts, and we knew that. He had an amazing ability to remember people's names and events, and somehow could do large figures in his head without a calculator. Dad also knew every small town that's featured on global newscasts, and generally knew somebody in that community. And that's because when he was district manager, as Jimmy said, he did the store visits by car, and he knows or knew every inch of British Columbia. When he retired, Mom and Dad rarely sat still. In the winter, they golfed in Arizona at their home with their friends and colleagues, and then they split their time in the summer on the water at their place in Seychelles and golfing locally with family and friends in South Surrey. Dad took on retirement like his job. He prided himself in keeping the gardens and windows in all three of their homes in ship shape, certainly stayed away from the vacuum, and of course, took pride in beating Mom at golf. Although he would say quietly to us that we would all have a much better day if Mom beat him. Mom and Dad are very competitive when it comes to golf. Dad was such a positive guy, never wanting to talk about bad or negative things in life, but rather chose to focus on the good things and having fun. He loved people. He was a real people person with a great sense of humor and the life of every party. And he had a wonderful gift of making everyone around him feel special. Dad and Mom taught us our strong work ethics. Between the two of them, they enforced commitment, hard work, and passion to have fun doing what you love and that family always comes first. Dad loved all sports. I remember fondly watching hockey night in Canada as a family in all of the communities that we lived in, but especially Fort St. John, with the howling winds and snow outside and our family safe and sound inside, and back then, believe it or not, cheering for the Chicago Blackhawks. Having said that, Dad would be very proud of the Canucks starting the season this year 4-0. He was also a great athlete and believed in the power of teamwork, and so Mom and Dad worked as a team to raise us three kids. Dad acknowledged Mom as the most important influence in his career, and that he never would have been so successful without her running the household and ensuring we kids toed the line, which we did most of the time. Mom and Dad had this strange sense of fairness that if one of us stepped out of line, we all suffered the consequences. And that was quite unfortunate for my sister Gail, as she was always the most well-behaved. But on the same token, if one of us did something well, the whole family enjoyed the success. Most of our family time was spent at sporting events and eating lots of dinners, with each other and with our extended family and friends. Every meal had to have at least one dessert, as Dad had a real sweet tooth. He loved Mom's homemade baking best, but was very fond of all chocolate, like those little chocolate bars that you have at your tables. We're still finding empty wrappers hidden in our house. I remember most of our early years spending weekends in the stores that Dad managed. That was back when the stores were closed on the weekends. We would play in the box bins. We were simple kids. While Dad stocked the shelves and Mom polished and buffed the floors, getting the store ready for Monday openings. Dad loved his friends and family's attention, but he was never selfish. And even when he was very sick, and we would be with him at his appointments or trying to brighten his day, he was worried that we were taking time for him, and even more worried if we missed work. For all of you, the world has lost a great guy. For us, we've lost a best friend, a mentor, and our dad, who had unconditional love for his family, no matter what the circumstances. Things will never be the same for us. It's hard to believe that Dad is God. He is our rock. It will take time to get our ship afloat and heading in the right direction. But we know that Dad will want us not to falter, but to carry on with the values that he and Mom have instilled in us. And as hard as that seems right now, that is what we must do to honor him, his name, his legacy, and all that he worked hard for in his life. There will never be another Gary Heppel, but he'll always be with us in spirit, and I know he'll be there when the sun shines. And I know he would say, because I read it in the speech he wrote, "Your future is in your hands. Work hard. Be proud of your accomplishments. Love the people around you. And for God's sakes, don't forget to have fun."
Stood there boldly, sweating in the sun. Felt like a million, felt like number one. The height of summer, I'd never felt that strong. Like a rock, I was 18, didn't have a care. Working for peanuts, not a dime to spare. But I was leaning solid everywhere, like a rock. My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right. like a rock, like a rock. I was strong as I could be, like a rock. Nothing ever got to me, like a rock. I was something to see, like a rock. And I stood arrow straight, unencumbered by the weight of all these hustlers and their schemes. I stood proud, I stood tall, high above it all. I still believed in my dreams. Where'd they go? 20 years, I don't know. I sit and I wonder sometimes where they've gone. And sometimes late at night, oh, when I'm bathed in the firelight, moon comes calling a ghostly way, and I recall, I recall, like a rock, standing arrow straight, like a rock, charging from the gate.
Okay, folks, hey, let's have one more time for Gary Helpline. about wraps it up for today. And certainly very, very, very honored to see everybody here today. And thank you very much for coming. Daryl, thank you very much for overriding the support all the way through the event and for the years. Thank you very much for Newlands, another great job. I know my dad spent many, many years at Christmas parties and certainly service awards and big meetings right here in Newlands. You know, we talked a little bit when you know, he was sick about where and how we should have the service, and he used to always change the subject, but he would say, there's only two places I feel comfortable, it's at the Richmond Inn and at Newlands, and Lord forbid we can't go to Richmond Inn, there's too many stories at the Richmond Inn. So he said, by default, we gotta come to Newlands, right? So thank you, Newlands, again, for a first-class job. Dale Luniak and the production crew, thank you very much, great job. Julie Dixon Olmsted for your guidance, appreciate it as always. And folks, please stay around and join us for some appetizers, some refreshments, and some fellowship. Thank you all so much again. This means so much to us. And please take care. Thank you.